Hey Maria, how are you?
Hi, how are you?
Can I just test my thing to share my screen and test it?
Yeah, sure.
All right, perfect. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
Can
Long
you all
time.
see it?
Yep, we can see it.
Okay, I just wanted to do, hang on.
Oh yeah, I want to do the same. I
Just to
was getting
test it.
nervous.
I
Just
just
not
want to do,
quiet.
there are a couple of slides that I have sound, so I want to know whether you can hear it.
Grace Cowardin.
Hang on.
And just FYI, I'm recording already the session because
Okay.
Alex want to send to our other parents if they're not here.
I just wanted to. Oh, you want to share yours? You want to try yours, Becca?
Yeah, unless although you're already recording,
Yeah,
right?
no, I was. Oh, you're recording already? You wanna?
Yes. I can pause it if you need me to.
Yeah, let's do it.
Work from home.
Okay.
And our daughter Ayla is attending in the fall.
Great.
She's gonna play volleyball for you guys.
Oh,
Nice.
So
Nice.
we're the new Valiant cheerleaders from afar. Yeah.
Awesome.
Wonderful. Have you all
So
been to campus at all?
we did. So we were able to sneak a trip in last year in October. Like New York opened up. Hawaii opened up, and I was like, we are jumping on a plane right now because there's no way I'm sending you that far away from us without going to see the campus. So,
Great.
it was like all this COVID testing. Nobody really even knew what was happening. Hawaii had just started this new COVID testing, and it was just like crazy mayhem, but it was a great trip. We were there for like 5 days, and we spent one day on campus, and we had like all of our meetings, like back to back to back. And of course we couldn't go in anywhere because like no nothing was open, but what a beautiful campus. And it was good because we stayed in White Plains, but the day we went there it was a little bit overcast and kind of rainy, and I was like, oh, this is good, babe, you need to see this because like it's not gonna be Hawaii there. This is fall, fall is cold, fall is rainy, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, so we'll be coming a little bit early to drop her off because they have to be here by the 18th of August. So
Wow, awesome.
I will get off and be quiet now so that everyone else can join in. Nice to meet everyone.
You too.
Nice to meeting you. What else? Who else we have here? I will start the official presentation at 6 just to give folks time to come in, but I want to hear who. I know I see Bernadette. I know you're where you're joining us from. I like your background.
It's my home.
Nice.
I'm not too far from Manhattanville. We're just in Putnam County, and I am a school counselor actually in high school, and I'm also a mom of a kid who's coming
Nice.
in September, and I'm also a graduate of Manhattanville. So,
Ah,
yeah,
triple threat.
triple threat. Good
Feel free
memory.
to say hello. Anyone who join us, Lisa, Susan, Olivia, Rebecca, feel free. We don't bite. We will get started. Like I'll give another minute and we can get officially started. But welcome to Enville. We are excited to have you all here.
I'm really excited that you opened it up for people to talk because last time we were just all very quiet. We were all very quiet and good little students. Didn't say a word. We don't think we even asked questions. And I was like, well, I'm not even gonna know any of these families, like that, how can that be? So I'm really glad it's like more casual and more open today. So thank you.
Anytime. I'm glad you're here. Lisa's driving, so I don't want to ask Lisa questions, but please be safe and just have your eyes on the road. It's okay. You can hear us.
You probably have a
Hi, this is
hands-free device, so you're not driving and texting or zooming, right?
All right, we'll get
I'm
started.
in the same situation. I'm also driving. Hi, this is Susan.
Hi.
Hi, Susan. Welcome, Marlene.
Thank you.
Welcome, Susan. So we'll get started. I know like we see some folks joining in, but I want to be respectful of your guys' time. Again, welcome to Manhattanville. I will be recording. If you guys are not okay, let me know. But we want to make sure we have this recording for any presentation parents are couldn't make it today. I know Alex, which you probably already have been talking this whole probably year. he's actually the director of student activities. So I want to introduce myself first. I'm Maria Moreno. I'm the assistant director for student leadership. So we are the fun office, Holly. That's why we like to talk. This is what I do. This is what I love to do. And we really, really try to engage our students on campus. So we really work. We really don't have a formal like place for the family, but we are building a place for you to know what's going on. So today I want to give you information on what the students will be going through. And we also have amazing, amazing folks here. We have Dean, Rebecca LaFleur on your, I think for me, it's on the right side. Dean, say hello. And
hello.
Professor Benita Mehta, right? That's how everyone pronounced it correctly. And they will talk to you about academics, but also first year program. But first I wanted to share a PowerPoint because I do want to give you an overview of what the students are going through this summer. And then at the end, you can ask us any questions you might have. Please, please don't leave with questions. That's what we're here for. And if I don't have the answer, I will definitely talk to Alex Barkley, who's my director, and I'll get you that information because he's handling orientation. But I did want it to meet. I love meeting families and I love talking to the parents of all the amazing things Manhattanville has to offer. And I know you know some of the campus already. So I will share my screen. Let me know if you can actually see it. I have a PowerPoint just coming your way. Please let me know if you can see it. Yeah. Yeah. So again, this is a place for you to ask questions. So Valley and Up Meet, we want to make sure our students first do a list of things right before getting up to campus. So it's an orientation. We also will talk to you, like I mentioned, about academic life and then first year program with our dean here and also our professor that will be speaking to you. And then at the end, again, if you have questions. So Valley and Up Meet, what is Valley and Up Meet? So it's an actual virtual half a day student orientation program. And it's gonna be running from 8:30 to 2 p.m. in different dates. So the students have to sign up for each day. I think the June 30th is already full. So we have July 7th, July 9th, July 13th, August 13th. And it's a place for our students to really get started on, you know, different paperwork that have to get started, but also meeting the resources that we have here on campus. And trust me, we have a bunch of resources, right? So I kind of wanted to give you some of the dates here. So if you want to take pictures, but the first day is a formal program introducing Enville to them. And then we actually, again, have a resource fairs from 1 to 2. And then this is going to be taking place on Zoom. So Valley and Up Meet is like when we first meet them. So it's a student orientation half a day program. Any questions about already this half a day program? This, again, it's going to be, you can ask them to sign up for June 30, July 7th, 9th, 13th, or August 13th. I did want to tell you the students will be able to connect in small groups during this half a day, right, with orientation leaders and also the staff as well, CECIL staff. The students also going to learn from faculty and staff members about their story, where they come from, right? One of the things we wanted to do for orientation this year, it's for us, it's important to learn where everyone comes from and know the valley and story. So students are going to be very interactive. And again, we'll be learning from incoming students across different places about their story, where you come from, why are you here? And that's what we are trying to do. So that's gonna be, again, Valley and Up Meet, and that's gonna be via Zoom. I did wanna show you here that if you go to enville.edu-orientation, you can see all three process of what orientation is gonna look like. Again, online, and then the actual in-person in August, but I wanted to just show you quickly, I'm gonna stop sharing here my screen, what that website looked like, just to have quickly an idea so you can see it. So you guys can see it? So this is the website once you go to, again, enville.edu orientation. So Valley and Up, it's online, so it tells you exactly what students have to start doing. So if you click here, and again, valuing up me, it's signing up for the half a day that I just went over. So you have to, again, this one is closed as I can see. So you can have, you have to tell your students to sign up for one of those dates. And then the level three is the fun one in person. And that will be in August, at the end of August. So you can find more information about it. And we're trying to put, as again, as much information for you guys so you can know exactly what are we doing this summer. So the first one, again, signing up for that first half a day orientation. Any question thus far? Okay, go back and share. Sharing the PowerPoint. Can you guys see the actual PowerPoint or no? No?
No.
Okay, let's see. It doesn't show me that you're seeing that. No?
No, it says you're sharing, but it's just a blank screen.
So weird. See technology. All right, I'll try again. You probably see it now.
You're good.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so signing up. So academic life, I know I have Dean Rebecca LaFleur, Arts and Science, talking about academics. So I will let her introduce herself and a little bit about what it means to be, you know, the curriculum is looking like, academics. And then we actually will have Professor Benita right after for the first year program. So I will have the questions to be asked at the end, if that's okay, but here you go.
Great, okay. Thank you, Maria. So no I'm problem. Going to see whether I can share. Our test worked out earlier. Good, thank you. So again, whoops, I think I'm on the wrong slide though. So I'm Rebecca LaFleur. I'm the interim dean of the School of Arts and Sciences. And so I'm really glad you've joined us tonight. This has been a strange year doing most of this through Zoom, but I guess it is nice in that we get to have families from Hawaii and all over the country joining us. I've been at Manhattanville for almost 1 year, so I'm just about to hit my 1 year anniversary, and I'm very much looking forward to everyone being back in the fall, holding these things in person again. And I hope your students will stop by. I'm in Brownson Hall, right on the first floor. Love meeting students. And so it's been a very quiet year, or doing most of it virtually. So I'm gonna try to not talk too much. I have a few slides I wanted to go over about the School of Arts and Sciences. I can also comment on the School of Education and the School of Nursing a little bit, if anybody has students in those areas. Hold on, I'm just gonna hide this for a moment. So some of this, I won't lecture too long, but I just wanted to make sure everybody was sort of on the same page when it comes to what the focus of Manhattanville's curriculum is. So regardless of which school your student is going to be studying in, SAS, School of Ed, School of Nursing and Health Sciences, they're all gonna be receiving a very strong grounding in the liberal arts. So I wanted to highlight a bit about why I think liberal arts is so valuable, what that looks like here at Manhattanville. So when I'm talking about a liberal arts education, really referring to just a specific set of disciplines that students will get grounded in. So the humanities, the arts, the natural and the social sciences. But they're also going to receive a very strong liberal education. And by that, I'm going to use a direct quote from the Association of American Colleges and Universities, that a liberal education empowers individuals with broad knowledge and transferable skills and a strong sense of values, ethics, and civic engagement. And that really is important. A lot of families ask, what is my child going to do with this, right? They're very concerned about life after college, getting a job, developing a career. And the skill and knowledge areas of greatest importance to employers really are all linked to the skills and knowledge they're gonna get through a liberal education. So things like oral communication, critical thinking, ethical judgment, working effectively in teams, working independently. You're gonna hear a lot about that, I think, through the conversation about the first year program, self-motivation and written communication. So these are all traits that employers have said, this is what we're looking for when we're hiring somebody new. And so I think they get all of that through Manhattanville. So the primary way that we accomplish this is through our liberal education, through our general education curriculum. So a few things I want to point out, because I think it's important to share this, that we regularly revise our curriculum, and the general education curriculum went through a very big overhaul last year. So this past academic year was the first year that we shifted to this new model. And one of the main reasons that the faculty chose to revise it was they wanted it to be streamlined and flexible. Our previous curriculum could be cumbersome at times, and it was sometimes difficult for students to be able to have a second major or declare a minor and fit their first major and their general education requirements in. So by being more streamlined, it gives more flexibility for students to pursue a variety of different interests. So the first big piece of our gen ed curriculum is the first year requirements, which you'll hear a bit about from Professor Mehta. But this introduces students to the mission and the ethical values of Manhattanville College, but also focuses a lot on fundamental skills, writing, oral communication, information literacy, and technology. Students will also have the opportunity to explore rich liberal arts education across disciplines. So we have a distribution requirement or model where students are going to take classes in the arts, humanities, global perspectives, languages, and natural and social sciences. And all of our gen ed curriculum together really does support Manhattanville's mission of educating global citizens. The other big piece of your students' curriculum is going to come from the academic major that they select. So whereas the gen ed curriculum makes the students well-rounded, provides those key skills that we think they need, the majors where they're going to gain specialized skills and knowledge in a discipline of their choice. So the number of credits and courses that students take will vary by program, but you can anticipate that at least a third of their coursework is going to come from their major. If it's a science course, or if they're getting perhaps a Bachelor of Fine Arts, that's going to require a bit more coursework within the major, but generally a third. We have over 50 majors to choose from within the School of Arts and Sciences. Some of the most popular are psychology, sports studies, communication, and media. Other options might be ones that you and your students are very familiar with from their high school curriculum: English, biology, mathematics, but still others they may have never heard of before or considered. And that's really why we encourage students to use that first year to explore, take a lot of different courses as they're fulfilling their gen ed, but also to get a sense of what might they want to pursue more in depth as their major. So in addition to the overall gen ed curriculum, their major, there will still be space in their curriculum for electives or additional academic programs and opportunities that they might want to take advantage of. So a lot of students will declare a minor along with their major. Ones I'd like to highlight would be American Studies, Religion, Women's and Gender Studies. We also have a Castle Scholars Honors Program. I don't know if we have anyone here tonight whose students have been invited to it, but if they have, I would strongly encourage them to join. It allows them to take honor seminars every semester, to take an honors section of the first year program or the first year seminar. And just a great opportunity. So I'd really encourage people to look into that and consider joining. I also strongly encourage students to do internships, not the first year, but by junior year. I think that's a really good opportunity to take advantage of through our center career development office to get a sense of, is this something I want to do as a career? I might think I know what I want to do, but let me get that real world work experience before graduating from college. And then the other thing I would highlight are our 4+1 programs. You might not be at the stage where you're ready to think about your student going to graduate school, but we have a few programs that I think are really special in that it allows students to complete both their bachelor's degree and their master's degree in 5 years, because that senior year, they're starting to take graduate level courses. So we have several with our School of Professional Studies and our School of Education. We have art education. So those are important things to take a look at to see if that might be something that your student's interested in. The other thing I always like to highlight is that much of the learning your student is going to do at Manhattanville takes place outside of the classroom. So I wanted to highlight a few things from last year that stood out to me. This is just a very short list. There are a lot of great events that took place virtually last year. So attending a virtual screening of the theater program's production of Twilight, or actually being in the production of Twilight. I attended a great panel of faculty, students, and staff discussing violence against Asians and Asian Americans. That was really powerful. We had the sociology program coordinate Ella Baker Day, featuring civil rights activist Ella Baker, talking about her legacy. And that was great to see faculty and students working together. We had a lot of students who presented their research through the Westchester Undergraduate Research Conference. And then there's lots of opportunities for students to work directly with a professor. So for example, one of our biology professors has students who work with her on her work rehabilitating sea turtles, which was always nice to hear about. So it's really important that students get involved outside of the classroom, right? Lots of opportunities to do that. So the first year can be very overwhelming for both students and their families. So I like to point out that we don't expect them to go it alone and that there are a lot of resources and support on campus to help students out. So one thing I'd like to highlight is our academic advising model. You've probably already been in contact or your students have been in contact with our professional advisors because they're the ones who work with them throughout the summer to prepare their fall schedule, select courses, offer advice about potential majors they might be interested in pursuing. We have four professional advisors and pretty much all students are assigned to a professional advisor during their first year. The exception might be for students who are pursuing one of the majors in the fine and performing arts area, where it's important that they get connected with a faculty advisor right away so that they graduate on time. But for students who might not know what they're majoring in yet or don't need to start focusing on their major right away, we like them to work with their professional advisor first. Then by sophomore year, once students have declared their major, they'll transition over to a faculty advisor. Where they'll meet with them at least once a semester. I would recommend more, but to talk about what classes they want to take the following year, to assist whether they're making appropriate progress within their major. And then we also provide a software program called Student Planning, where students can log in anytime and really get a quick access to where they are in towards their degree. What classes have they already completed? What classes still remain? It also has a really good function that lets them say, well, you know what? I'm thinking of switching my major. What would happen if I switched from psychology to sociology? And it'll actually show what classes are still remaining so that students have a good sense of what they need to do to complete their degree in a timely fashion. I'd also like to point out our Academic Resource Center that provides peer tutoring, supplemental instruction sections, in a variety of different areas. So if somebody needs assistance with math, with biology, with English, we can match students up with a peer tutor to help provide that additional support. Our Center for Academic Writing also provides that sort of one-on-one support for all stages of the writing process. So students can either drop in or can make scheduled appointments with a peer tutor. Some of our students in the MFA program in creative writing also serve as peer tutors in that area. So lots of support available for students to seek it out. So I think that's one thing we try to remind first years of, is that there's a lot of opportunities on campus for that type of support and pointing them in the right direction, where to go for that. And I won't talk about these things, I can a little bit, but there's also a lot of resources through our student services. So the Center for Student Accommodations, Student Health and Counseling are also good resources for students to be aware of. And finally, I just want to talk a little bit about what you can do to support your student, because this can be a hard thing as students transition to college, what the role of parents and families should be. So I like to think of it as you need to transition to the role of coach, right? You want to set it up so that your student is advocating for themselves, is independent, but you're there to support them and guide them along the way. So definitely stay connected with your students, but give them the space to be independent. So check in via email, via phone, but allow them to make their own decisions as much as possible. Guide them. It's important that you become knowledgeable of campus resources. So take a look at our website, get to know as much of the different resources on campus so that you can guide them as well. Help your student learn how to navigate those resources. Encourage them to be a strong advocate for themselves. So if they get their first assignment back from a professor and maybe it didn't go the way they expected, don't be the parent who reaches out directly to the faculty member or the family member who does that, but help your student figure out how they could approach their instructor, the types of questions to ask, how to approach different people on campus, right? So being there as a resource for them, but helping them be the advocate for themselves. Definitely encourage them to attend office hours with faculty members. We have a very welcoming group of faculty who enjoy spending time with students both in and outside of class. So encourage them to take advantage of that. And then again, I'd say help them explore their major and career options, but don't choose their major for them. Let them have that choice. You can guide them, provide feedback, but let them make that choice. So I recognize this might be easier said than done because it is a certain amount of letting go of some of the control you may have had in the past, but you've gotten your student to this point. Now you need to trust them to get to the finish line and become more independent. So I'm going to end there and stop sharing my screen.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Dean, Rebecca, I know some of them might have questions. Some of you guys I already know. So we will leave the questions towards the end, so just write it down. And I did want to say in the chat, I am putting our email. So if you have other questions aside from here, or if we don't get to answer one of your questions, you can follow up with myself or Alex Berkeley, the director for the Center of Student Involvement and Leadership. And again, we are putting a family support web series. So the next one was going to be June 30th. And we're going to talk about what our students are doing outside the classroom. I know the dean mentioned a few things, but we have a lot of resources and we're going to have a few folks actually coming to speak to you. So we will have this throughout the summer. So check out, and I always will be announcing the following one. So June 30th via Zoom again, meet us here. We'll talk about all the great things we have, but thank you so much, Dean. And now we have our professor, Benita Mehta, who's going to talk about our first year program. Benita.
Oh, hi, everyone. My name is Benita Mehta. I'm actually professor of French here, but director of the first year program since last July. And it was an interesting year because it was most mainly on Zoom, but we managed to do quite a bit. And as Dean Loeffler actually mentioned, we did a lot of events, a lot of them on Zoom, and actually we had great attendance because I think Zoom, you have a captive audience. So she mentioned some of the different events, but through the first year program, we also organized a number of co-curricular events. As part of the first year program, there's an academic component to it where every student actually attends a first year seminar. And then we have a writing class. So every student actually attends a writing class. And then that writing class continues into the spring semester. But the first year seminar is only one semester. And it's a theme based. So I'm going to start sharing my screen just to give you an idea as to what the content of the seminar is. So bear with me while I get my screen up and running. All right. I'm hoping you can see it.
Yes, looks good.
All good.
For education.
Right. Okay, I'm going to go back. I'm sorry, I don't know why it started. Okay. All right. So the first year seminar is called First Year Seminar is Principles versus Prejudices. And that particular title is something we've had for the last 2 years. It's a common syllabus, well, sort of common syllabus. We have some common texts and some texts that are selected by each seminar instructors. But the title itself comes from an essay written by a president of Manhattanville College. Her name was Mother Grace Damon, who wrote a speech called Principles versus Prejudices in 1938 after the college admitted its first African-American student. So we were way ahead of the curve in admitting our first African-American student. And there was some opposition faced from some alumni. So she actually gave a speech where she talked about the importance of principles versus prejudices. So that's the actual main, a speech that we all read and discuss. And then we have another common read, and I'm going to skip around a little bit. So the seminar itself has the speech by Mother Damon, and then it has a common read. For the last 2 years in 2019 and 2020, we read the book by Angie Thomas called The Hate U Give. Some of you may be familiar with it. It's also made into a film. So that was also part of the common read. So every seminar section, and last year we had 20 seminar sections, every section reads the Mother Damon speech and then the common read. Our common read for the year for fall of 2021 is a memoir written by Daisy Hernandez. It's called A Cup of Water Under My Bed. And Daisy Hernandez is half Cuban, half Colombian. So the theme is actually a Latinx theme. In keeping with our new designation, Manhattanville has just been designated a Hispanic serving institution. Sorry, thank you, Maria. And so I think it goes very nicely with that theme. So we'll be reading. So the two main texts are the speech and the common text. In addition, each seminar instructor adds their own additional readings. I'm just going to go back a little bit. As I said, the speech itself is very mission-centered, right? So what is Manhattanville's mission? And you're going to hear a lot of this. Our mission is to educate students to be ethical and socially responsible leaders in a global community. And then you can read on the right-hand side, we are committed to the various things on the right-hand side, creating a diverse and inclusive community, engage scholars and teachers, helps our students to develop as independent and creative thinkers, and also to serve as leaders within a global community. And so this first year seminar is very mission focused, so directly deals with some of these mission, subheadings within that mission. What is the actual first year student learning objective? So the first thing is to develop critical and reasoning skills through investigation of the theme of principles versus prejudices, right? So what does it mean to have principles? What does it mean to have prejudices? And how do you kind of merge the two, or how do you negotiate between the two? Develop an understanding of Manhattanville's mission and history of social action. Identify and apply ways in which the campus resources can be used to maximize your academic and personal goals. Develop collaborative problem thinking skills. Reflect on personal assumptions, expectations, and goals for your college experience in relation to your investigation of principles versus prejudices. So these are the goals of the seminar. I'm going to go back to this now. I talked about the common texts, right? In addition to the common texts, we also have common experiences and common assignments. So there are three different assignments, three main assignments, which is called This I Believe, Taking a Stance, and We at Manhattanville. And so each seminar creates an assignment. Everybody works on these assignments, these three assignments. And then we have something called Me at Manhattanville, which is a series of assignments. You do at least a minimum of three assignments where students have to actually attend an event, a co-curricular event outside of class, and then write about it. So what we try to do in this class is try and build in the curricula with the co-curricula. So it kind of forces our students to kind of engage with what's going on campus. And we work very closely with Maria's office, which is the Center for Student Involvement and Leadership, to create these extracurricular kind of experiences. Before I go on to the next slide, what I've included in the next few slides is going to be a recording of a larger video that was created, a PowerPoint with audio created by our archivist, Lawrence Yarko, for the first year program, which tells you a little bit about the history of Mother Damon and who she was and what the speech was about. So each slide will be accompanied by audio. So please let me know if you don't hear the audio. So I'm gonna move on to the next few slides.
Grace Cowerden Damon was born in 1872 in Baltimore, Maryland. She was remembered as a brilliant student in her youth, but most of her education was informal. By 18, she had decided to become a nun. However, her family was opposed. She waited over 7 years and in 1898 left her family home without telling them and entered the Society of the Sacred Heart. She never officially earned a college degree herself. She spent the next 30 years as a teacher and later administrator in various Sacred Heart schools, mainly around the Philadelphia area. She came to Manhattanville in 1930 as president when the college was just 13 years old. On February 17th, 1938, a man named Father John Lafarge wrote to Mother Damon. Lafarge was a Jesuit priest and editor for America, a weekly Jesuit magazine. He was well known for his writings against racism and anti-Semitism. In 1937, he wrote a book entitled Interracial Justice, A Study of the Catholic Doctrine of Race Relations. In it, he argued against separate but equal segregation and pointed to economic and societal exploitation as the reason for racial disparities. In his letter, Lafarge asks Mother Damon whether a Black student with all the qualifications necessary could apply and be admitted to Manhattanville. He notes she is from a Catholic family in the Harlem area, and her father is a physician. Mother Damon spends the next few weeks ensuring the trustees' support and ultimately putting it up for a student vote. The student vote results in 79.6% voting in favor of admitting the Black student. The decision is made, the student is accepted. In early May 1938, seven anonymous alumni, having heard of the decision, send a letter to all alumni, parents, and friends of the college. In it, they write, "Has it come to your attention that Manhattanville College has accepted a colored girl as a freshman for next year? Do you wish colored women as members of the AASH, the Manhattanville Alumni Association, or the Children of Mary? Are you prepared to accept these women on a social basis at all alumni functions, sewing meetings, to gatherings at your homes? Do you wish your daughter or other young girls exposed to such future social contacts? Do you not feel that the religious, before taking such a drastic step, should have consulted the alumni? Will you send in a protest, either signed or unsigned, before College Day, Tuesday, May 31st? Help a loyal and devoted group of Sacred Heart women bring the serious results of this unjust social action to the attention of our beloved religious." In total, the archives have about 20 letters and telegrams reacting negatively. Their language and rationales are unfortunately too familiar to us.
I think there's some seems to be a problem here, or let me just see. Sorry.
It's okay. Can you try to go back and forth and see?
Go back?
Yeah, to the front.
Let me see if I escape this. Mm-hmm. I think I hit the mute button and that's what probably stopped it or something. Let me just try. Okay, sorry, just going to stop sharing one more time. Let me try one more time and get to that slide. Sorry, technical difficulties.
No worries.
Okay, we start from the beginning. I'm just going to resume slide.
Today.
Okay.
Well, I think the audio went away again.
Yeah, I am.
In contrast, the archives have about 30 letters voicing their support for the decision in the couple of weeks after the anonymous mailer. Many took issue with the concerns of the anonymous mailer. One alum wrote, "A college, which is only, as the anonymous correspondent seems to think, a source of alumni functions, sewing meetings, and gatherings at home and social contacts, would be too petty and unimportant to remain long in existence." Another wrote, "More members of the alumni who fear for loss of social prestige have to me failed to grasp the sum and substance of their Catholic college education, where their concept of all that social implies is so superficial and limited." All the letter writers note how proud they are of Manhattanville and some even admit they were initially surprised, but they know it is the right and just decision. In the beginning of the speech, she noted, "It is natural for us to form prejudices. We grow up taking prejudices out of the air about us as we take up germs. The point is that we must provide ourselves with mental antibodies for our mental health, just as nature provides us with physical ones for our bodily safeguarding." Later on, she addresses the anonymous women and those opposed directly. "We strove to develop in you the power to think and to reason. You have a right to these things, and if you have not got them, at least in some degree, then you are not really Sacred Heart women, and our education has failed you." Near the end, she notes the destructive legacy of slavery and racism and invokes future generations. "The injustices and greed of our forebears left to future generations this grave problem for solution. Closing our eyes to it and imagining the dire consequences of any steps taken to right those wrongs will not help those who come after us." In July 1938, the college published her speech in full. They also decided to publish selected letters of support with identifying information.
Okay, this final slide shows you a little example of our final project, which is known as We at Manhattanville. And this time we did it over Zoom. So this is just a screenshot of our Zoom event. And basically it's a project where every student, they work in groups to create this, create a multimodal project. It could be a poster, it could be a video, it could be an audio project where they talk about them, the situation, what it is being a Manhattanville student within this historical context. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen. I just wanted to clarify one thing. I could have prefaced the remarks saying that when Manhattanville, when the speech was written in 1938, Manhattanville was a women's college. It was a Catholic women's college run by the Sisters of the Sacred Heart. So that's why you have that whole religious context to the speech. But it's very interesting, I think, to talk about, and then of course, Manhattanville did not become became non-denominational in the 1970s. But we have this rich heritage. And one other thing that we do with this is I showed you some archival records of people who were for and against the admittance of the student, and our library archivist actually comes to the seminars and does a little project with the students. So students actually get to see these letters, which are in our library's archives, and work on a project related to that. So it's kind of neat because they get to see these letters written in 1938 and actually get to handle them and look at them. And so it's a fun part of the seminar. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Professor. And again, just summarize, I know it was a lot of information, but we have the half a day orientation for our students to really sign up in one of those days. June 30th is already full, but make sure you look at the other dates as well. If you have questions in the chat, if you just scroll down Zoom and press the chat button, you can see our orientation at enville.edu for questions for Alex or myself. And then again, we will have another different webinars along the way. So next time, meet me on June 30th via Zoom, and we will talk about campus life outside the classroom for our students, and you get to know what resources we have. All right, question time. So I know you might have some questions, so we are opening it up for questions for either us three. So I will just allow you guys to just unmute yourself and ask some questions.
I have a question. How does campus life and everything work when your child plays a sport?
Okay, so campus life, I guess I'll answer. I'm the student activities person. So you get to balance it. Obviously we have a lot of like great support system here. But the great thing is like they can actually work with their coach, you know, to see how the academic and support that they can provide and work with the faculty. So I guess they can do it, of course. We have a lot of like different athletes that do both. But again, they always have, you know, an academic advisor to help them as well. But then they have literally athletics here. It's great because they have like great coaches that can work with them with the sports side of things. But we do have a director of athletics. So my office don't exactly oversee that, but we can always put you in contact if you have further question about like balancing both. They probably have more idea of like giving you an example of how their life is looking like, you know, through every day.
I can add a little bit to that, not too much. But one thing that we do have is we have a system for early alerts. So if a student is struggling in a class, something's not going well, the faculty member can raise an alert. We used to call it a flag, now it's an alert. And if the student is an athlete, I believe often that is shared with their coach so that there's multiple people reaching out to try to get that student back on track. Because we don't want someone to be surprised at the end of the semester. We'd rather, let's identify a problem first, work together to fix it, identify solutions for that as it's going on rather than after it's too late. So I think people do really work well together collaboratively to support all students.
Yeah, and the great thing is all first year get a mentor, peer mentor. So I know we had a lot, believe it or not, a lot of athletes benefited from the peer mentoring program because it's a way to kind of like have someone, upperclassmen that went through it, and some of them are in sports so they can relate. So I think it's all really, really great to have the support of faculty and staff, a peer, so they can relate to academic and life outside as well. Thank you for your question. Any other question? Ali, I think you have one, right?
Hi. Lisa, I'm not sure if you have a son or a daughter and what they're playing, but our daughter's playing volleyball. So if we have to bond over some sport, thing, I'm here for you.
Thank you. I actually have a son and he's playing baseball.
Okay, wonderful. Well, yeah. Maybe our kids will get to know each other, so that'll be fantastic.
That'd be awesome.
So,
Lisa, hi, I'm Susan. My son is also playing baseball.
Oh, there we go.
Yes.
That's so cool.
That is.
And I was the one who was also in the car, and I just got home.
See, I was driving. I'm actually down here. I'm actually at Purchase. For my daughter swims over here.
Wonderful.
So my question was on the academic advisors and the first year they get their professional advisor, would that have been something that our kids would have already been assigned in this whole thing that they're going through? Like, should they have already met that person, and should they have already been like working with them to get their classes and stuff? I just kind of wanting to know, like,
yeah,
I'm trying really hard not to micromanage this.
Good for good. Yeah, so I believe what happens is they don't have a specific advisor yet. They haven't assigned them. So sometimes they might do it based on areas of interest, try to match them up. But they should have received an email, I believe, that we had a course preference form where students would fill that out, and then they would create a schedule based off of that. They were mostly done with that the last time I checked, and they said, well, you know what? It's also, though, prom season and graduation season. So we'll reach out again after that passes to see if is anybody that they were missing, but they should have had some sort of contact.
And yes. Somebody then contacts them if they're like the one who hasn't, because they just graduated and they're kind of behind earlier graduation people or whatever. Somebody from you guys contacts them and says like, hey, how come you haven't signed up yet?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Just making sure. Okay.
And yeah. I did post it the chat here, the orientation website, so you can find the first step. If you can like find any, you know where to go, like if you have questions about like the form, who do you need to contact? So I did post that on the side. Thanks for your question. Any other questions?
I'm sorry, I can't see everybody. I'm still on my phone. When are the kids supposed to be on campus?
Awesome question. And that's the best part, right? So again, I know that we jumped through a lot of different things. So the first level, let's just call it level, so it's easier. Level one is to complete an online home, preference form. And then also what I said, a half orientation online via Zoom with us. And then that's the second. And then the third one, it will be on in campus. We have Friday, August 23rd, classes start. So right before, we're still figuring out the actual moving date, but at the end of August, they will be on campus for the first in-person orientation.
Can you give me the dates again? The classes start.
Oh, yes, it's on. So if you click, do you guys have the chat? Can you access the chat? So it's easier so you can see it. Let me share the chat with you guys so you can see where to find the website, actually, because it will be easier. So if you need more dates, sometimes we forget, but let me know if you can see it. Can't see it yet.
Actually, okay. Classes begin on the 27th, right?
Yes, the first day of class.
First day of class, but I think the weekend before that is the orientation, the final orientation.
Yes. So here, okay, sorry, I'm not sure if you see it, but yeah, I have here the first day is, again, orientation level 3. This program takes place end of August, right before the start of classes, Friday, August 27th to the 29th. There you go. 27th to the 29th, that's where all the Grace experience orientation take place. And again, you can see it. I know there's different dates and things like that, so you don't get confused, but we have 3 different levels, online and then in person in August.
One thing I would add, going back to Holly's question, and this might be the thing to do as you're sort of helping your student make sure they're staying on top of everything, but not micromanaging. It's that tough balance. The other thing they should have received some emails about, I believe, was placement tests. So for math, science, and languages, that's something they can do in advance that might determine which classes they should take. I think if they don't end up doing the placement tests, that's okay. They'll just get assigned to sort of the beginning level and then could always readjust during the add drop period at the very start of the semester. And I put the academic advising email in the chat in case anybody needed to reach out to them.
Awesome. I'm assuming these emails are going to their Manhattanville email that they got.
Yes.
Okay, just making sure.
And the great thing is, like I said, it's so nice you guys are here because we will cover like a lot of the technology as well for you guys throughout this web series. This is just like the intro, but where to go, what we have Blackboard, all this stuff, what they do outside campus, like all the great things you'll get to know if you follow all the series throughout this summer. So yeah, but if you have questions about like where to go, you can email us and we can direct you to the actual department, whether it's IT or academic advising. We always like communicate with each other. So that's one thing that we try to forward any emails with questions to the direct department. Any other questions? I know some of you guys have been probably in communication with Alex Berkeley, my director. I will be taking over the webinar series, but if you have any question about orientation, he is actually the person that created the orientation, in charge of orientation. So if there's a question that you might have here, please just email us and I will direct it to him because I know like he's the orientation guru here, but I'm here to support you guys through this journey. So at least you know what we have here at Enville. And again, thank you for joining us today. If you have no more questions, I'll see you June 30th with what our students doing outside the classroom. We have folks coming to speak to you. Thank you so much, Dean Rebecca, and thank you so much, Professor Benita, for having, you know, coming to speak after hours. Thank you for the parents and welcome to Enville.
Thank you for joining us and looking forward to meeting all the new students.
Definitely. Bye-bye. Thank you for coming, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.